thank you very much for the invitation and the possibility to speak here today. And I thought of bringing a topic to you, which I think even in Sweden might be kind of interesting, and for not necessarily scientific reasons, but for all the other ones out with your activities at the Karolinska. And that would be about cannabis, and particularly cannabis exposure in a very specific context, which is pregnancy. And why I thought of bringing the topic up here is really also to highlight to you that actually you can do research at the interface of society. And I do think that actually you can, you know, when we talk about translational research, or we talk about, you know, the medically relevant research, then you can find really new topics every day in which I think, besides the scientific excitement, there is some societal significance. So if you think of just the cannabis plant, then I would think that we can all agree that God's creation of this plant, or evolutionary biologists' creation of the plant, you know, is not because we want to smoke pot. But in fact, and the psychoactive contents of the cannabis plants are not really to give us pleasure. But in fact, it's for a very prudent reason, and that is that all what we find pleasurable actually in nature are those compounds which repel insects from the plant. And this is what, you know, evolution actually, roughly about 600 million years ago, invented for the survival of this particular species. So when you look at cannabis, even though we tend to classify cannabis into subgroups, but by taxonomy there is one type of plant, which is the cannabis sativa. And if you look at the history of the plant, then certainly initially it has not been used at all for its psychoactive contents and components, but instead it was used for its fibers. So it can produce 6-7 meter long fibers, and actually they are really durable. So for clothing and all the ancient industries and societies, they relied on this this species. And actually, back in the day, most of the plant really had just minute biologically relevant amounts of psychoactive components. Now, as selective cultivation actually had worked and progressed, there were two different types of preparations, which are really consummatory from the plant. One is the dried flower buds, which you see here, and actually which is illegal in many countries to have at home. This is where you find the highest concentrations of the psychoactive components, particularly tetrahydrocannabinol. And the other form is the oil extracts, which are usually marketed. Now, depending on where you're coming from, of course there are very strong beliefs and views on cannabis and the use and the benefits or the risks of cannabis. And certainly the situation, particularly the legal situation on cannabis, is changing extremely fast. I mean, if you think about the US itself, of course there is a difference between East Coast and West Coast. I think you are all aware of Colorado and all the other states which are legalizing or have legalized cannabis. And at the same time, perhaps there is less of a debate going on in Europe, or it's a less visible debate going on in Europe about cannabis legislation. But by and large, we can say that whilst so far the Netherlands was the only country which had for a while legal cannabis, and here I got to say that this status had changed since this drawing was made. Many other countries are changing its views purely on political grounds, and much less so on scientific grounds, unfortunately, on how to deal with cannabis and cannabinoids. And I think the problem really is that people usually tend to forget that in the plant there are roughly about 400 different components which are bioactive. So we tend to look at THC as the major psychoactive component versus cannabidiol, which I think you are hearing more and more about, particularly because of the chewing gums and the epilepsy treatment options which it might offer. But we tend to forget that, you know, there are roughly about 398 other components in there, which might even be more powerful had they been in higher concentrations or higher amounts in cannabis. So I think it is really important to see that, you know, nature gave us kind of a very complex creature in this plant, and dissociate really the primary effects or the useful, so far considered useful effects, from all the unknowns which actually give us an extreme potential for discoveries and particularly for maybe even medical uses. Now, the medical use of cannabis as a painkiller actually is nothing new. It had been described first time roughly about 2,800 years before Christ in China, and it has ever since been used either alone or in different preparations and in different combinations and mixtures as a painkiller. And the account is really, really prudent and very, very detailed. Now, if you look at the more recent history, then you got to go up to 1964 to 67, when chemists had defined the primary structures of THC itself. And since then, synthetic chemistry had evolved also by providing synthetic analogs and synthetic equivalents to the plant active components. So 1967 is the time when actually this discovery has been made. And I think if we go a little bit of kind of societal relevance, then the late 1960s is when the research into cannabis was defined as such, as a need, as a societal need, particularly because there was an epidemic of use. And the reason being is that cannabis is not classified as an addictive drug. So when you wean off cannabis, then usually there is a psycho preference for cannabis, but you will not see a physical addiction to the drug. So people who use it, they feel the psychological benefits of using it, but unlike other drugs, you will not have the physiological response patterns. And I think this is one of the reasons why it was considered a harmless drug in many ways, or something which you can take without, you know, additional challenges on your body. And let's continue further on, because of course one issue for research was to understand how really the cannabis constituents work, and it was until 1990 that the first receptor was cloned, which is the cannabinoid type 1 receptor. Not too surprisingly, you would argue that again our brains and our body does not contain receptors because we want to smoke cannabis, but instead maybe there is some sort of a system which is through evolution became a bit diverse from what we see in the plants, but still mediate some sort of effects. And indeed this is the case, because in 1992 and 1995, after cloning the receptors, the idea and the discovery came that actually there are compounds in our bodies which act alike THC, and these were called, and these are called, the endogenous cannabinoids, or the endocannabinoids. And as you might really think, it is really important in the sense to define the way of how these compounds act and how they influence physiology. And what I will do today is really just show, first of all, the principle why we have endocannabinoids in our bodies. And through this, I hope you will understand why and how, for instance, THC might exert its effect on our brains. And I will really only focus on brains. I must tell you that by and large, every organ system contains cannabinoid receptors, either type 1 cannabinoid receptors, or maybe some of you also heard about type 2 cannabinoid receptors, which is more the immune lineage driven cannabinoid signaling system. And there are some orphan receptors which certainly have preference for endogenous compounds, which we can classify as endocannabinoid-like compounds. So going back to also these studies, I must emphasize that most what we know about how cannabinoids work is really on studies of the cerebral cortex. So I will by no means say that these are general rules, because we have no idea or very little idea about other parts of the nervous system, particularly in a human context. So what I think you all will appreciate is the number of cells and the number of connections within the human brain. Let's translate it simply into other terms. So each cell has roughly about 40,000 connections. So that would mean that it requires an ability and a programming and a computational power that as if you were able to talk to a whole village of 40,000 people at the same time. And that also means that there needs to be a very powerful system which filters out the jitter, filters out the irrelevant information for that particular cell, so that it can really be embedded in functionally relevant networks. And I think this is the starting point for the understanding of how many of the molecules in our brains really act, because these are the rules, these are the novel principles which actually we just start appreciating now. So how do we make, how do the cells of our brain make sense of all that overload of sensory and other information which receives, which you receive or anyone receives every second, every moment of our lives. So if you go to the very simple network, which is just two cells, so we negate 39,999 connections. What you can see is that this communication pattern is very much timed and very precise. And the precision comes from the temporal resolution, meaning the two cells have to communicate in a way that it carries information. So I guess you all have heard about the Hebb's doctrine, which means that depending on which is the pre and postsynaptic cell, when they are active and how they are timed, the information between the two cells will be either amplified or lost, and the packets of information transfer will be determined at very specific sites, which are the synapses, right? And these synaptic sites really are the conduits of information transfer between the two cells. Now, what we all learn, I think, from secondary school on, is that these synapses provide an information transfer route from the presynaptic cell to the postsynaptic cell through the release of vesicles which contain neurotransmitters, and then there are postsynaptic receptors which will translate this signal into something meaningful for the other cell. What we have roughly about in 2000 realized that essentially this information pattern and this information transfer cannot be infinite, because if it is, then it becomes pathological. Look at, for instance, in epilepsy. If in epilepsy there is an upregulation and there is a runaway activity between two cells, then this is the epileptic attack. So to keep the whole system under control, you need to have some sort of signaling network which actually can mute the release of the neurotransmitter at a very specific threshold and very specific points in time. So in other words, there needs to be a backward operating system which from the recipient cell will tell to the other one that, hey, it is now enough. And this is exactly what endocannabinoids do. So they are breaking networks of communication between two cells, and as such, they do it, as we see it today, almost at every synapse. So what you look at is really a general rule and a general function defining the activity of our brain and the patterns of activity in the brain by liberating endogenous cannabinoids and cannabinoid receptors sitting in these presynaptic endings. So if you look at where the cannabinoid receptors are, then just take this slide here in a rat, and the darker it is, the more receptors you have. So as you can see, the whole cerebellum is really loaded and packed. The reward circuitry from the dopamine reward circuitry into the striatum is all packed. The entire cortex and hippocampus, so the higher cognitive functions and the memory formation, are all loaded. A little bit less you find in the thalamus, in the relay circuitries. And the same you find exact same organization of the system you find in humans as well. So you might argue that actually it is not only that in every synapse you find endogenous cannabinoid functions, but it is that particularly those sites which are really important to defining higher brain functions, the limbic system and the motor system, and higher complex output are the ones modulated by endocannabinoids. Now you can really visualize what endocannabinoids do, and this is on this slide, and I don't want to bore you with complicated experiments, but let's just look at it in a very simple and principled way. So again, we go back to the two cells which communicate with each other, and what you see is that every downward deflection is one moment when the first cell shouts at the other one, okay? And then we can stimulate the second cell to produce endocannabinoids, which is here this step. And what you see is this, this shouting is really decreased, meaning again, the inhibition of the first cell occurs. And this is roughly on 20, 30 seconds of time. Now, 20, 30 seconds in neuroscience is roughly about geological timescales. So it is like dinosaurs died out yesterday, okay? So really think about that this cell, again, is able to fine-tune the activity of all the 40,000 inputs which it receives and can receive at any given time and filter many of them out because it shuts them off. Like, I don't need you no more, you know? And this is what really is happening here on these timescales. Meaning that there is really a very logical and conscious refinement mode what endogenous cannabinoids do. And I think this is not too surprising if you think about that many of the people who smoke, or most people who smoke cannabis, they have usually episodic memory loss, right? And this is exactly because you are not selectively shutting off circuitries, but actually you are shutting off your circuitry. And therefore, you know, let's put away that you want to fly and you want to jump and whatever. But therefore, there will be certainly a change in cognition and in cognitive performance. So when we talk about smoking cannabis, then there are two really very specific areas which we need to distinguish from each other. One is the recreational cannabis use. So when you think about the slide I had before, that shows an intact system, a physiological system, right? Onto which you can superimpose additional cannabis effects, and thereby you will really modulate and overmodulate the physiological structure and the physiological communication avenues. And thereby you will modulate an intact system. This is what happens when someone smokes cannabis, you know, recreationally on Sunday afternoon or whenever. The risk here is that you have too much of a good thing, perhaps. So besides the endogenous cannabinoids, you have the phytocannabinoids, the plant-derived cannabinoids, and the effects will summate together. Now, the other type of use is the medical cannabis use. And medical cannabis use has relevance in all these situations when the endogenous system is faulty, when endocannabinoid signaling is not operating either at the levels or at the pace and place when it's required. For instance, in epilepsy. This is why medical cannabis use is getting prevalent, particularly with cannabidiol, which is the non-psychoactive cannabinoid, because what you are doing, you are restoring the endogenous control structure. So you are setting it back to the quasi-physiological levels, and by this, you are providing a remedy to one to all those runaway activity patterns which otherwise would take place. So if you just want to look at indications of medical cannabis use, I must say that this list is really glowing, but initially it has been considered for nausea and vomiting, particularly as partial therapy in cancer patients, or stimulating appetite in all those conditions where this is a major issue. It is indicated for spasticity in MS patients and in injury, and then we are going through towards the newer indications, particularly epilepsy or anxiety, depression, and most importantly also for withdrawal of other drugs. And I think this is one of the increasing and very relevant medical uses of cannabinoids and cannabis these days. So when you have this kind of list, then you can have a bit of an overrun, an overshot, what you see in publications and in public literature these days. I certainly would warn that perhaps there is limited research basis of all these statements that cannabis can cure everything. I certainly haven't heard of a patient with credible information who has been, for instance, cured of cancer with cannabinoids alone. It certainly, I think, the highlight is that the proof is still out there. We needed more. regardless of which side of the fence you're sitting. So whether it's, you know, governmental agencies or whether the end users who believe in the effects of cannabinoids. Now, in terms of the, I think it's good to highlight this, that in terms of the drug evolution, how companies looked at it, the major leaders of cannabinoid products are still isolating these from the plants. So from plantations, they take cannabinoids, whereas the newer ones are all going towards the synthetic compounds. Importantly, there was a breakthrough story roughly about 10 years ago when Rimonabant was actually marketed for weight loss, and unfortunately, because of its side effects, this line of medication collapsed. What I think is more relevant is now that besides the THC line of work, so the psychoactive type of work, the cannabidiol line, which is the non-psychoactive major component of the plant, is gaining pace, and particularly in epilepsy with children. And I think this will be the second part of my talk where I'd like to really address what we know about brain development and cannabinoids. And just very briefly to show you that brain development, as you all know, has a very specific and a very much evolutionary defined pattern from the production of the cells towards the migration of the cells to their final positions, the establishment of their connections, the surplus cells dying at the same time, and then increasing the pace of communication with the expansion of the nervous system. And this is, of course, is also reflected in the size of the brains and the brain volume and in the enrichment of the structure in cells and in connections. And I think it's also important that these processes do not cease until adolescence, which in humans is like, you know, matter of definition, but certainly until, I would say, 17, 18, 20 years of age, there might be sensitivities and sensitive processes which certainly will define outcomes for the rest of the life of the individual. Now, if you look at cannabinoids and how this all comes together, it is that cannabinoids are usually considered as an age-specific drug, as a niche drug. So cannabinoids are taken by young individuals from the age of 11, 12 up to 16, 17. Later, for a long time, it has not been cool to take cannabinoids. So there is a kind of a match between brain development, particularly postnatal brain development, and the use of cannabis. Importantly, the potency of THC is really much increasing in the cannabinoids available in the streets, particularly because of selective cultivation. And at the same time, cannabinoids or marijuana is the drug which shows the increasing number of hospitalizations as well. All the others are steadying out. And I think when you look at this, then the important element is that on heavy cannabinoid use, the outcomes are addiction, certainly altered brain development, poor educational outcome, cognitive impairments, and diminished life satisfaction and achievements, and even on psychological diseases later. And I think this is the point I would wish to highlight, in the sense that it's, again, if you think logically, brain development and imposing maybe modifications to brain development might have relevance to all these outcomes which are listed here. Just a remark, that if you look at this chart, what you can see here is that there is a comparison between tobacco use and cannabis use. And this is the times when the EU banned tobacco advertisements. So this chart is until 2013, but by now, actually, cannabis use among students is more prevalent than tobacco use. So there is a switch in societal appreciation and societal preference also between cannabinoids and tobacco. So if you just take one of the populations which has a high tendency of using cannabinoids, and this is London, and actually they use a very specific cannabinoid which is called skunk. It is a really stinky one, but the point is that its potency is roughly about 3 of the general cannabis what you would buy in any other cases. And then what they have done, they looked at the number of hospitalizations, particularly with primary psychosis. And there is a very clear interaction between those kids who started it earlier than the year 15 or who had cannabis exposures after or past the 15 years of age limit. And certainly this suggests that the earlier the starting point is, the likelihood of ensuing psychological episodes and problems in or psychological complications will be increased. And this is where I think it is important from a research perspective and a research point of view to understand what is really the underlying problem or what might be those points of sensitization and sensitivity which define these outcomes. And just, I could stop here basically on this concluding slide. I think I will have like 5 more minutes to tell you a bit about research. But essentially what the last 10 years compiled in knowledge is that endocannabinoid signaling is not only important for adulthood and the communication of cells, but also how the brain is built. So many of the cells can produce endogenous cannabinoids from their generation onwards, and they can communicate with other cells during their lifetime and during their placement, the final placement in the brain networks and layouts. And again, once this is disrupted by, for instance, recreational cannabis use, then obviously all these layouts, all the blueprints of how our brain is supposed to function will change. So the major steps would be the proliferation of stem cells, which produce all the inhabiting cells of our brains, the migratory routes and the pace of migration of various neurons and glial cells. Also, how many of them survive after sitting in their final positions. And once they arrive to their final positions, how will they grow connectivity and how will they grow complex connections with one another? So I would really say that this is the point when cannabis smoking during pregnancy becomes important and looking at it becomes important. Because basically, by the maternal ingestion of cannabinoids, there is a chance. It's certainly not, you know, a fact that in everyone this is happening, but there is a chance of changing the offspring's brain architecture. And you might think that, you know, okay, but how important really is? I will just show you one slide where this is a human fetal brain, a 20 week of human fetal brain, and this is the hippocampus, and this is the entire cortex, and again, the darker it is, the more cannabinoid receptors you see. And if you look at it, also all those sites which I've shown you in the adult, they are all by mid-gestation, by the 20th week, all packed with cannabinoid receptors. So the likelihood of an effect of cannabinoids is really high. And if you look at the statistics that, for instance, in the US, in a population-dependent and certainly societal preference dependent manner, 7 to 17% of women smoke cannabis during pregnancy. I think this is an alarming number, meaning that there might be more to than an anecdotal story to these effects. So why I think it's really important to look at cannabinoids and cannabinoid signaling is because in developing cells, the cannabinoid receptor as a protein is migrated to a very specific site, and this is called the growth cone. The growth cone is the site by which axons grow, which senses the environment, and through which cells will physically connect to one another. So if this process of growth and the process of communication during growth is disrupted again by exogenous cannabinoids, then you might really have again, even a discrete neuronal and cellular sites for why disruptions to brain structure will occur. And just would want to show you this slide, and that is that when you use lasers, you use electron microscopy reconstruction, then there is so many cannabinoid receptors in these growth cones that with this marker alone, you can reconstruct the entire structure. So this was reconstructed by immunolocalizing cannabinoid receptors. So it really is packed. And the concept of really what is happening is a very simple one, but I think it's a very exciting one, and this is where I will leave you to today, and that is that enzymes in our bodies can only degrade endogenous compounds, right? The enzymatic machinery can degrade the endocannabinoids. All the enzymes that you have cannot degrade plant-derived cannabinoids, meaning that if someone smokes cannabis, then the metabolites are in your body roughly about for 2 to 3 days. So it's detectable for a long period of time, okay? But in a growing neuron, the machinery which otherwise would be able to degrade the endocannabinoids, which are required by the endocannabinoid system for the natural growth process of the cells towards each other, will be biased if you put exogenous cannabinoids, particularly tetrahydrocannabinol, on them. That means that the cells will get signals of detour. So they will be disrupted in deciding, am I going the right way or am I going the wrong way? And the selection process, how cells select partners of communication to each other, will be disrupted. So in other words, if we go back to the analogy what I had at the beginning, there is one cell which communicates, supposed to communicate to 40,000 other ones. If you turn the phone book upside down, then you will never understand the phone numbers, what to talk to. And this is typically what's happening when there is exogenous cannabinoids in the system, that the code which is guiding the cells to grow towards one another will be disrupted and will be eliminated, and thereby the connectivity patterns will really change. And just to show you as really the last slide of how does this look, in axons growing in a normal mouse, you see that there is a really nice flow of individual axons or very small clusters. If you give this mouse cannabis during pregnancy, then you will see the axons lose path and they lose the structure. They collapse on top of each other, and therefore the structure of this mouse will change. And this is what really you also see in many of the human cases, that the connectivity patterns in humans change. So with all this, I will leave you with the idea that dependent on when and what type of cannabis usage had occurred during pregnancy, there is a probability, certainly at least at the level of probability, because we are genetically all diverse. So, you know, there are many underlying factors which can sensitize and protect individuals from cannabis effects, that the brain structure will change, and these changes might actually be permanent, affecting the offspring during postnatal life and perhaps throughout life. So thank you for your attention.